We talked a little bit about Puppet and Puppet Code. And I wanted to kind of show from the command line, if you use Puppet resource and then one of the common sort of types, you'll actually get a blob of those things. And these are all valid. This is all valid Puppet. And this represents all the users on the box, right? So specifically, I'm interested in root, right? This is the root user. You can see all the sort of variables that are available for you for the root user. If we wanted to, we could actually kind of collect this and then use it as valid Puppet code. So I'll go drop in here. A lot of things that people want to manage for environments that are very, very small and just sort of brand new is root, right? I want root, I want a consistent root everywhere, make it happen. And so, all right, this is the root password, but then what invariably happens is you get somebody who logs on who's like, what's the root password? Well, I don't remember, I got sudo, so I'm just gonna take care of this. So this is the new root password. Oh, too simple, doesn't matter. And now, if we go look at sort of the root user. So remember DAM, right? The very beginning of that. They've changed it, and that really sucks, right? So the sort of the fantastic thing about Puppet is by default, Puppet runs once every half hour. By default, if Puppet detects drift, Puppet will remedy your problem, right? So we can do Puppet apply this amount of code. But I'm just running code without any testing right now. So maybe I'll just step back a little bit and test just a hint before I do anything. All right, so we run Puppet apply no op, which basically says just, you know, dry run. Tell me what's gonna happen. And we come back and say, oh look, root's password's changed. I would have changed that, but you told me not to. And now we actually do want to send it back to the way it was before. Great, so now we are in compliance, and not only that, but we got a report that we're out of compliance, so we can go find out why we drifted and remedy that problem. But this is sort of where like people start, right? So I just need to manage a user, let's just start there. The next thing is sort of this trifecta of file, package, service, and I wanted to just kind of show an example of one of these. So we're gonna find environments. And so this is sort of the next stage, right? So I have a package that I want to install. That package has a configuration file, and that package represents a service, and I want to tie these things all together, right? And this is sort of like the second version of Hello World that everyone writes. And so this is great, and this is how you get started with Puppet. Another perfectly valid way to get started with Puppet is, so let me bring this up. So we saw this before, right? We're going to do some module magic. So I haven't been managing NTP, and I want to go ahead and manage that, so I'm going to go ask the forge to go ahead and get NTP for me. So, not only, you shouldn't, for some things, you shouldn't have to necessarily write everything, right? You should be able to, people have written NTP modules, people have written Apache modules, matter of fact, people have written like 52 Apache modules that are on the forge alone, but you should be able to just get this started. All right. Now what? All right, so this is where sort of Puppet Enterprise kind of comes in and hopefully makes everyone's lives much happier. So let me get this to where hopefully people can see it. Yeah, we can see this. So unresponsive nodes aren't actually unresponsive, they just haven't checked in yet. What you see here is sort of the default landing page for Puppet Enterprise. And the hope here is to really sort of give you an at-a-glance understanding of where you are right now in time, right? So not only where you are, but where you've been. So you can see that since this is my demo environment, I just spun it up yesterday. I only have histories for 2 days. The little red bar is me doing some demo prep for this, where I was breaking stuff. The very thin orange bar is where I was running some no-op runs. Green bar is everything good, nothing changed. And blue bar sort of everything is good and things did change, right? So the idea being, like, I should be able to scroll very quickly and understand, like, what the state of the world is right now. And let's just drill down into one of these nodes and sort of understand a little bit deeper what's available to us. So this is CentOS 64C, actually 6.4C. This is a delicate snowflake in my laptop environment. I care very much about CentOS 64. So I can look at sort of over time what's going on. We can drill into any individual puppet run and kind of understand from metrics like how long did that puppet run take, what changed, what didn't, how long did that take overall. So, you know, one of the things that people always ask is, how do you scale Puppet? And then I ask them, do you know how long catalog compiles take? Do you know how long these things take to run? And the answer is, well, not really. So that all of this information is kind of critical to understanding so that you can build out your infrastructure, and it's all right here for you. We can drill into like the log if things did change, in which case, in this event, they didn't change. And we can drill into events like down to like what line and what Puppet module actually kicked off this event. You know, what was the change? What's the config file that underlies that? And we can kind of look at things that way. The other thing that's sort of nice is that inventory, or basically all the facts are exposed this way. So it turns out Puppet knows an awful lot about any one of your systems, more than most people care about, like down through BIOS information, or if you add Forge modules, like the warranty information, you can see, am I in warranty right now? How long do I have to go? And you can, these are all sort of available for you to act upon when you actually are writing your Puppet modules. The other thing that you can see is sort of this notion of groups and classes. So we're talking about classification. There's a couple different ways you can classify. We're talking about roles and profiles. And those are actually classes. So they could go into the far side class, but they can also go into this notion of groups. And the idea behind groups is just a higher level way to aggregate all this stuff together. This is my web tier. This is my database tier. These are nodes that I care about this way versus nodes that I care about some other way. And you can basically just edit, compose, right? So in a very easy way, sort of add functionality. We did add functionality, actually, a minute ago. We added NTP, and NTP currently isn't available for us, but let's just go ahead and add it. So we're gonna go to add classes. Tell me all about NTP, all right? Well, as you saw before, we had talked about, Ryan talked about sort of composing your modules, right? These sort of, the bottom four modules are just, our bottom four classes are actually classes that where the rubber meets the road. Your users don't care about that, right? They don't want to have to tie config to install to params to understand where goes what with who. In the end, they just want to install NTP. Right, so the only thing that we are going to choose to export in the sort of the view that they're going to see is just the NTP module. So there it goes. I think that everybody should run NTP. So I'm going to go ahead and add a group. And I'm going to call it NTP. We're going to add a class to this. Happens to be NTP. If we wanted to, at this point, we could actually drill into it and actually set any of these parameters, right? So what servers I use, am I gonna really, you know, do I have any special settings around panic or restrictions or anything else. In the end, I'm going to assume, or actually I know, that NTP has pretty sane defaults, and I'm just going to accept those. At this point, we could go ahead and add nodes to this, just because I'm going to go ahead and throw a couple on there. Basically all of my CentOS 64s. And we'll go ahead and create that group. So if I go back and drill into CentOS 64 at this point, you can see there's a new group, it's NTP. I get it because of who I am. I get it because I'm CentOS 64. You can actually compose groups. You can have groups within groups, and you would understand at the interface level, why did that get classified for me, right? Where did that come from? So if you have questions about, like, I don't understand why this node is getting classified this way, Puppet Enterprise tells you why. And same thing for classes. Individual classes, why did they get applied to me? Well, NTPs got applied to me because I'm in the group. So let's just drop out real quick, and I'm going to go to CentOS 64C. And I'm going to do this sort of the old-fashioned way. I'm going to kick off the Puppet agent right now. By default, right, Puppet runs every 30 minutes. I could wait some number of minutes between 0 and 30 for the next Puppet run to kick off, but I'm impatient, so I wanted to tell Puppet to do something right now. I'm also, I didn't really test NTP, so let's go ahead and test it. Don't mind the syncing. That's a bunch of plug-in syncs. So this is what would have happened. If we scroll up a bit. All right, so the config file is different, and this is how I would have changed it, right? And where I am the Puppet agent. And other things that I would have done is go ahead and refresh the service. So if it's not running, I'm going to make sure it's running. Okay, great. So that all looks relatively sane. Go forth, do what you want to do. And in the end, yes, we change the config. Yes, we restart the service. And so this is sort of a great way to see sort of what's going on. There's another way. This tab in Puppet Enterprise, it's called Live Management. This actually backs to the mCollective service that you've heard a lot about. So you can do all kinds of things. And the way that I like to describe it is if Puppet is the static configuration, mCollective is the ad hoc tool, right? They both know the same things, because in the end, they're asking PuppetDB, not necessarily asking PuppetDB, but they have the same sort of information about, like, Puppet knows better than you do what your nodes look like. So in the end, I can do things like, all right, I know that I only did that for the CentOS boxes. So mCollective or Live Management, where the OS family is Red Hat, I want you to go ahead and just look at those. So ignore Windows, ignore Solaris. I just want Red Hat families. And go ahead and run Puppet once. Now, you can do a whole bunch of things in here, right? So you can change the Puppet master. You can run tags for that particular run. If you want to run NoOp, you can do that. If you want to splay out these runs so they don't hit all at the same time, you can do that. If you want to set the environments specially, you can do that. All I care about is that they're going to run Puppet. So they're going to go forth and run Puppet. And that's sort of fantastic. In the meanwhile, we're going to kind of head over to another feature of Puppet Enterprise, which is the Event Inspector. So you've heard a little bit about this from other folks, but the idea here is that Puppet has a tremendous amount of insight into what's happening. And oftentimes, when we talk to our customers and say, what are your biggest problems? The answer comes back is, I have no idea what's going on right now, right? So everything was fine 20 minutes ago, and now everything's blowing up. Every pager in the office is going off. Everyone is coming over to tell me that the website's down. Everyone's pretty aggro about it. The monitoring system seems to also concur that things are going badly, but I don't know why, right? Did anyone, so how many of you have done this where you didn't work in an office like Puppet, where somebody pops up and is like, okay, did anyone make a change in the last 10 minutes, right? And you know when somebody says that, the answer is always like, oof. No, I didn't make any change. I don't know what you're talking about. In the end, a tool like Event Inspector lets you sort of drill down in that, right? So show me in the last 30 minutes or the last 60 minutes, the last 3 hours, you know, what's happened. And then let me drill into those changes in a very sort of easy way. So just from nodes, tell me about just nodes. Oh, I see that three nodes had changes. Let's drill into those. Okay, of those changes, one of them was a file change, and one of them was a service change. Well, tell me about the service change. Well, the service change, it was stopped, and now it's running. Oh, that's great. So it must have been restarted because of this configuration file change. So tell me all about that, right? And you can drill down into the individual line and the individual Puppet file that kicked that change. And that's a pretty powerful thing. This config version is actually a configurable parameter. In some people's worlds, they use that to point back to a SVN version or a git hash or a remedy ticket that basically is responsible for that change, right? So like for people that are change control board aware, right? So what ticket kicked this off? Because it broke, and clearly some process needs to be improved, right? Or what git hash broke this? I'd like to use the tool git blame, which is both a fantastic and terrible name for a command, to figure out who did this so I can figure out what part of our process needs to be changed so this doesn't happen again, right? Because production went down, I got in trouble, and we definitely don't want this to happen, right? So. The other kind of nice thing about Event Inspector is it actually provides links to drill all the way down, straight into the run, where you can drill into the event, where you can drill into the content that this resulted in, right? So that you can understand very quickly the actual changes. And the end goal is really just to provide insight into what's happening and why. And then if you do some amount of integration to that, right, you should be able to tie that into your existing tools, your existing source code management, your existing review board tools or your existing review tools. Like, did the review happen? Oh, the review did happen. Why didn't we catch this in the review, right? And you can improve your process. In the end, it's not about blame. It's about like adding another unit test or figuring out why, like what, where did this happen and how can we prevent it, right? So one of the other things, but that's just NTP, right? So there has to be something more than just NTP. Well, let's go back and sort of look at an actual application. So for people in the room that are familiar with Jenkins, we'll go ahead and deploy Jenkins. So real quick, nothing up my sleeve. CentOS 64A on 8080 is nothing right now. Oops, come on. Well, you kind of see that it's nothing. And right now I'm going to drop into 64A. I'm going to go ahead and add a class for, oh, maybe I won't add a class for Tomcat. Do I have a class for Tomcat? I don't. Let's go add a class. So here, we're gonna add Tomcat. we've written a profile for Tomcat, which actually wraps this lower level Tomcat module. And it only exposes the parts in Tomcat that we want our users to change, right? So this is that notion of profiles and roles. And so I'm just going to add and provide profile Tomcat as something that my users can use. The underlying Tomcat, I don't want them to be able to change that. I don't want them to be able to tweak those outside of the parameters that I've allowed. And same thing with Jenkins. I'm going to add those two. All right. Now we're going to go find 64A again, wherever it went. All right, so I need Tomcat, and I'm going to go ahead and, just for the sake, normally I would do this in two stages, but because I'd like to leave some questions at the end, I'm going to go ahead and just do it in one. There is one thing, though, right? So in this case, let's say that Jenkins is a very fast-moving project. If you're staying on the kind of the quick releases, that can often like lead to some amount of heartburn. So actually, I don't want to use the latest version of Tomcat, right? I'm actually going to specify the 1.5.3 or the 1.5.3.1 release, which is from, I don't know, 4 months ago. That's how I want this to look. So I'm not going to change anything about the Tomcat parameters. I'm not going to redirect where the package comes from or the version of Tomcat I want to install. But you can imagine in a world where you had non-root, right? Tomcat's something that you can install, run on a high-level port. You can install it from a tarball. These are all things that you should be able to, as an application developer, I need this container. I want to put this war into it. I just want to be done, right? I don't want to have to file a ticket to do this. I just want, as part of my job, to be enabled to do this, right? So through testing or through everything else. Okay. We're going to go back to live management and kick this off. Finding some resources. Right now, what mCollective is doing is basically pinging across the message bus and saying, who's out there? Who wants to potentially do something, right? I'm not going to filter. I'm just going to go straight to 64A and say, I want you to run once right now. All right. And while that's running, because it's going to take a while, right, we're going to go out. We're going to pull down Tomcat, we're actually going to install that from a package. We're going to do some configuration file changes. We're going to then go out and grab Jenkins. So while that's running, I wanted to show some other features of live management. One of the things that often we get in sort of legacy environments is people want to know, well, I've had these like handcrafted artisanal VMs for years. And I want to understand, before I blow them away, what do they look like or what's different, right? What's different about this host than this host? Everything runs fine on this host, but never on this host. And tools like mCollective are great for this because they can actually answer that question for you. So Puppet maybe doesn't manage every user that you have, but mCollective can tell you all about them, right? So mCollective, tell me right now about all the users in my environment. And so mCollective is going to drop onto that message bus and ping out to everybody and say, I need to know about all your users. So go ahead and come back to me with that. So we're going to go out, Jeopardy sounds in the background, waiting for, you can imagine if you have lots of users, if you have lots of hosts, sometimes these queries can be sort of long-lived. For example, if we ran the package one and tell me about every single package you have installed across the five Linux hosts and the handful of others. Let's see what else we can talk about while this is going on. I love questions. Right, so let's say...
Can you repeat the question?
Yeah, the question is, how would you, with this I'm guessing with this tool, how would you go ahead and deploy a new version of Jenkins out to a handful of servers, right? So the idea might be you might have already classified them as Jenkins boxes, but you just want to point, you just want to push a new version, right? So mCollective, everywhere this class or a node has been classified with this class, so Jenkins or this whatever, I want you to go ahead and run a Puppet right now, right? And then mCollective would go out. The sort of one of the tools that I wrote previously around sort of warranty was mCollective, go out right now and tell me all of the hosts that I have that are out of maintenance. Because actually I'm about to do a renewal right now and I need to understand where I am, right? So we had another system that was sort of a partial source of truth for that. But in the end, like mCollective actually knows right now or can for some amount of time query and then know right now. So, all right, mCollective, why are you being such a pain? I'm going to maybe narrow. So this is all happening on my laptop. So maybe my laptop's getting a little bit overwhelmed by the fact that it's got two Windows hosts, a Solaris host and an AIX host sitting behind it. And it's like, I could do this if it was Linux, but Windows is too much. So let's just restrict it. So just for the Red Hat family, let's go find some user resources. Chances are they're not going to be that different. Okay, actually, there is some differences. And I bet those differences are the differences between 5.9 and 6. So, we're getting some more. We can drill into any of these. Let's go back. So for the user sync, right, there's just one variant. So they're all the same across all of those. So, but the user root, I bet that's not the same. Let's go find root. Yeah, four variants. So within root, on all of the 6.4 boxes, the password is different. The groups are different, right? And so we can start to see these differences and start to build out from there, especially for people that have legacy, like back out sort of these legacy environments and then puppet them up. So certainly other Puppet employees said it. Ryan referenced, I think it was Mike's talk at PuppetConf. Don't boil the ocean when you start with Puppet, right? Like it's very, very simple to say, like, I just want everything puppeted, right? But it's very, very difficult in large environments to do it. The hardest thing I've ever done was I left Cloudera, where I had this massive Puppet environment with tremendous amount of automation, and I went to a brand new startup that had like 8 employees and nothing, no servers, no anything. And I didn't bring any of that with me. And then I started from scratch because I was like, I knew what it was like when I didn't have to do this, right? I didn't have to write these modules again. I didn't have to write this automation again. But in the end, what I realized was like, part of it was like paralysis for the first 3 days. Like, where am I gonna start and how am I gonna get this done? I need to get it all done right now. Wrong. Users, sudo, and SSH keys was the place that I started. And then just incrementally improved that from there. They were lucky that we didn't have any legacy, but if they did have legacy, using tools like mCollective to kind of go back and sort of tease out these sort of puppetable differences is great. So let's see for fun if Tomcat's there. Tomcat's not there yet. So it's the great thing about demos on Wi-Fi's is like, maybe that Tomcat install is going to take a really long time because I'm also probably pulling down a JDK. But let's just drop into 64A right now and see what else is going on. So if anyone else has any other questions while I'm checking this out, go ahead and shout them out.
Would you worry about looking at stuff? In a production environment, just looking at stuff even?
looking at things doesn't make me nervous. So the question was, would I be nervous about looking at things in production? There might be some people who are nervous, but outside of who gets to look, I don't think I would be nervous. Certainly tools like mCollective can actually ad hoc make changes, and that would make me nervous, right? So the difference, again, between mCollective and Puppet is mCollective is ad hoc, right? I can say, mCollective, install this package on every host that looks like this. Well, that's an ad hoc thing. That's now lost to the history of whoever did it, right? So some amount of that is just like putting sort of processes around, you know, your tooling. So tools like Puppet can give you all sorts of power, but depending on your environment, maybe some of that needs to get restricted, right? Or maybe because of compliance and SOX and whatever else, like some of that needs to get locked down. In the end, what you would probably end up doing, or maybe you have managers who want to look, right? But maybe you don't want them to touch, right? So you should be able to use the tools like mCollective writing extensions to mCollective, which actually can query back to some DS and say, you're in this group, you have these rights. Right, so yeah, it's running. It's just taking a really long, oh, no, it's done. Yeah, sweet. Let's go check it out.
Oh, yeah. I just have a question about the live management GUI there. I have trouble understanding what to type in the fields there. Like it says no op. What would you type there? Yes, do no op or...
So they, if we go look at these, especially run once. Yeah, you. So I think the end it's sort of like string comparison. Sure, all right. Like this would work. So that's probably a great feature for me to take back and point to the PE team and to say, hey. Feel free to sort of specify what, in this case, might be a valid place. One of the things that we do try to do, especially if you provide sort of defaults in your modules, is that when we do parameters, if you provide defaults, we sort of tell what those are. So in the case of this version, the default is latest, right? So we could reset this if we wanted to and see that it's latest. So in most places in Puppet Enterprise, we try to hint. Clearly, that's one place where we could hint better. But in the end, yeah, you can drop something in there and it'll do it. All right, so. My poor laptop is actually like on fire. It's like kind of painful to touch. So, any other questions? That's a trick question.
Can you repeat that question?
What's the largest Puppet Enterprise deployment? So it turns out that there are just about as many ways to deploy Puppet as there are ways to use Puppet. So let me answer that question by sort of talking about the stages that people go through when they scale. So by default, if you take the default Puppet Enterprise installer and run it, you get a Puppet Enterprise master, you get a DB, a Puppet DB, and a console all in the same box with their various backing data stores with that, right? The first thing that people do is break those into three. So Puppet DB, Puppet Master, console installed on separate hosts. And maybe those are VMs and maybe they're physical hardware. That sort of depends on like how many cores do you need available, how many catalogs do you need to be able to simultaneously compile. And then from there, it really becomes a scaling question around like your environment, right? So your catalog is probably going to look very different than my catalog, but there are some sort of, in the end, there are some sort of tendencies, right? So Puppet masters can get scaled out sort of horizontally. So I have 1, 2, 3, 4 puppet masters, 1 doing CA in specific, 3 just doing puppet masters, all behind a load balancer. So HA proxy or F5, right? Like, doesn't matter. So then you can just scale that out. So the special snowflake in this case is the CA. And then everyone else is just a puppet master, right? And there's some magic around, like, well, how do you make sure all the module paths are the same and other things. But in the end, it just sort of depends on your environment. So there are some very, very, very large users. If you want to just be just kind of wowed in a people I'm allowed to talk about way, go look at CERN's talk from PuppetConf last year. Like, it just blows your mind the size that CERN's at right now. Not Jane. Come on. Wow, that's unhappy. Well, Tomcat got deployed. Somebody else asks. Let's see if I can remember how to get to Jenkins. Oh, right, I did that. My bad. Any other questions?
I mean, Chad, maybe just to put some numbers out there, like CERN is what, at 150,000 now, scaling to 300,000?
Yeah, but that's also between, I don't know how many masters that they're actually running that way.
Right.
So they, right. A lot of people can also expand this by having multi-masters. So we heard earlier today we had a master in every AZ. Some of our other AWS folks just put a master in every VPC. And that is around addressability. Like, I just want these hosts to talk to these one masters. And maybe they also have a master of masters who sits like higher up from that, who then like manages those masters. Because in the end, a master by default sort of reports to itself, but there's no reason that a master couldn't report to yet an upstream master and sort of take its cues, like, what should I look like, right? Module paths are just files on disk. So you should be able to manage those the same that you would anything else.
And I'll just throw out there, CERN is obviously the extreme case, but we have many, many customers who are at tens of thousands of nodes, architected very much the way that Chad kind of laid out there, so.
Is there any other questions? Is there anything I can show you guys in specific? Also, if you have like specific questions, like I said, I live here, I'll happily come talk to you in person and give you a nice demo. Or give your bosses demos. Cool. Oh, I guess we can look at reports. So one of the parts of Puppet that is, I think, also now becoming a lot more utilized is the reporting side. So in the end, every single Puppet run has the opportunity to spawn one or more reports, right? So I was talking with someone earlier, talking about a laptop use case, like if I'm managing laptops and everyone has root on the box, what might happen if they just decide to stop Puppet, right? I no longer can manage that box. And they have root, so they can do that. Yes, and you have a report that will tell you when the last time it was run, and so you can alert on some frequency, like these are the hosts that we haven't seen in 30 days, right? So even in that case, like reporting, putting reports into things like tooling, like if you have Graphite for metrics, like being able to track these metrics over time, right? If you're using Splunk, being able to use that to maybe trigger alerts or trigger other monitoring. If you have higher level CMDB stuff where you roll up a whole bunch of questions about like, where is this asset right now, right? Puppet should be able to tell you that. And so the reporting interface is sort of useful for that. The exciting part that I think everyone is really happy for, the NC that we alluded to that's coming, is going to have an API. So much like PuppetDB has multiple ways to interact with it, one of which is definitely in an AI. Or an API. From now on, like all the new services of Puppet will have those too. So you know, you'll be able to programmatically do that without resorting to like rate tasks or other ways that the current console uses. But it's going to be awesome. Any other questions?
We do.
I was just wondering if there's ways, like I have a large Perl library I have to take care of, and there's one system that has, you know, and all the files that get put into my site Perl get delivered by RPMs, and I want to be able to detect, you know, if someone changed a file, like logged on and changed the file and hacked it, or they put some file that's they added a file that's not supposed to be there, or deleted a file that's supposed to be there.
So the question is like, so I install a bunch of files that I care about in an RPM way, right, or a packaged way. Puppet's then going to basically manage that higher level RPM, but it's not going to necessarily manage like the content that came with that RPM, right? Versus like I could manage each of these files independently. And manage their content, in which case Puppet would manage that. Downside, your catalog would get huge, compile times would get longer, recursively managing directories is not something we recommend. We actually recommend doing packages. So how could Puppet help you sort of detect and find changes within those directories? That's a good question. CPAN. Right.
I have to deliver everything to an RPM, so I pull down my CPAN, I package it, and
log. Yeah. I mean, it manages while I'm managing it for dependency. You're looking more right about
so
RPM. If you do RPM,
then we also have modules that don't come from CPAN.
Yeah. So I think in the end, I have some ideas, but it'd probably be good to, like, take it offline. So see me after, and I will chat with you some more about how either. So Puppet can certainly help you. It's just I want to understand some of the other tools that you have in your environment, whether or not that would those.
PPM.
Sure. Any other questions?
All right. Well, and let's give away some certifications.